Bristol Community College, Mathematics with Dan Avedikian, Math 119, Fundamental Statistics, Section 2.2, Problem 4. This is Section 2.2, Problem number 4. It says fill in the blanks for the frequency distribution shown below. And you have a frequency distribution that's partially filled out, but there are a lot of blank areas. And you can really start in a lot of different places. It doesn't really matter where you start. I'll start on the left and go left to right, which makes sense. So I'm only given the class limits, lower limit and upper limit, for one of the classes. There's one class that's given that goes from 58 to 72. Now, the one rule I know about those classes is that there's no gap and no overlap for the classes. So if one class ends at 72, the next one has to begin at 73. It can't start at, say, 70 or 75. You can't have a gap, you can't have an overlap. So the fact that one ends at 72 is telling me the next one must begin at 73. Now that I know that, I can get the ending point for that class that begins at 73, the upper class limit. So the class before, what did I have to add to get from the lower limit to the upper limit? 58 and 14 is 72. So the class that I'm working on underneath it that starts at 73 must end at 73 plus 14, which would be 87. And now I have a class that ends at 87. So I know, because there's no gap and no overlap, that the next class has to begin at 88. And if it begins at 88, it has a lower class limit of 88. The upper class limit must be 88 plus 14. So that'd be 102. So now I have two classes that are still blank before the class that's given with the 58 to 72. Well, you can kind of work this one in reverse. I got the starting points for the ones that came afterwards, but the ones that came before, if the class that's given to me begins at 58, the one before it must end at 57, right? If there's no gap and no overlap. And now something plus 14 was 57. So what plus 14 is 57? 43 plus 14 is 57. And there's still one blank class, so same process. The class that I just figured out begins at 43, so the one before must end only slightly less. It would end at 42. So the beginning point of the class, or lower class limit, would be whatever number plus 14 would make me end at 42. Well, 28 plus 14 is 42. So now I have all the classes filled in. Now the next column, the frequencies, I have quite a few of those. The relative frequencies are what I can work on next. I can see that there's one relative frequency given, which is 23 over 100. So what that's telling me is for the class that that's the relative frequency for, the frequency would be the numerator of that fraction, 23, and the denominator, the 100, is the total of all the frequencies. So the frequency block that's next to it that's blank, I can see must have been a 23 because of the numerator of the 23 over 100. Now the first class has a frequency of 17, so its relative frequency would be the 17 for the frequency over the total of 100. And now, the next class with the given 58 to 72 class limits, I don't have either the frequency or the relative frequency. I know it's something over 100, but I can't get the numerator until I do a little bit more work. So the next class down after that has a frequency of 31, so its relative frequency is that frequency of 31 over the total of 100. And finally, the last class has a frequency of 9, so its relative frequency is that frequency of 9 over the total of all the frequencies, which is 100. Now, for that last missing part, what you need to remember is that the relative frequencies add up to a total of 1. And since the denominator we're working with is a 100, that 1 can be written as 100 over 100. That will reduce to 1. So let's add up what we have so far. 17 over 100 plus 23 over 100. I have a common denominator of 100. The 17 and the 23 add up to 40. So I have 40 over 100. And I'll skip the unknown one for a minute. 40 over 100 plus 31 over 100. So again, just add the numerators, keep the common denominator of 100. 40 and 31 adds up to 71. So I have a 71 over 100. And then you add the fraction underneath, 71 and 9 would be 80 over your common denominator of 100. So I have 80 over 100 for the parts that are known, plus the missing one, some unknown amount over 100, is going to add up to a total of 1, which can be written in the form of 100 over 100, because 100 over 100 does reduce to 1. Now written this way, 80 plus some unknown amount, it must be 20. 80 over 100 plus 20 over 100 adds up to 100 over 100, which does reduce to 1. So my missing numerator in the something over 100 was 20, which means the frequency for that class is 20. So now we've filled in all the blanks. I'll just mention that some books, some statistics teachers like you to write the relative frequencies in terms of decimals. I feel the fractions are fine. Even when they reduce, I like having all the same denominators. That makes it easy. The 100 is so easy to turn into a decimal, though. You just put in the decimal point. Let's say you didn't see it, so you do the numerator, in this case 17, divided by the denominator of 100. And the calculator would tell you that's 0.17. And then you do the same process for each one of these, though. With the 100 denominator, you really don't need to use your calculator. The 23 over 100 is 0.23, the 20 over 100 is 0.20, the 31 over 100 is 0.31. Be careful with the 9 over 100. That's not 0.9. That's 0.09. There's a big difference. 9 over 100 is 0.09. 0.9 is 90%, 0.09 is 9%. Imagine each one is the rate you pay in interest on your credit card. 9% you can deal with, 90% you don't want to. So I feel the fractions are fine, but if you have a class where they want decimals, you can just do the division for each one and put in the decimal.